What's up? I hope everyone is safe and coping well in this time of pandemic. I am Dr. Erdi Fadrigilan. I am a heartbeat specialist. And in this channel, I talk anything about heartbeat and its abnormalities. Before I move on, I'd like to mention this disclaimer. The contents of this video and the other videos I have in the channel are meant to spread and increase awareness. They are not meant to replace medical advice or consultation. So if you're cool with that, please consider subscribing to the channel and don't forget to click the notification bell so you are always updated. In this video, we will examine an interesting ECG tracing. I have already checked the standardization. It's at 25 millimeters per second paper speed. And the calibration of the amplitude is at 10 millimeters per 1 millivolt. I have already checked the durations, the intervals, and measured the QRS axis. If you want to know more about ECG standardization, electrode placements, and measurements of the intervals and durations, please check out the other videos I have in the channel. If you look closer at the ECG tracing, you will notice that there are already measured values and even interpretation in the ECG, which was made by the computer. And this is what we call the computerized interpretation of ECG. The attempts of having computers interpret ECG tracing started in 1950s, 50 years after Willem Einthoven invented the ECG in 1900. Computerized ECG interpretation potentially have benefits. First, it can improve accuracy of ECG interpretation. Number two, it can reduce cost. And three, it can improve delivery of healthcare. They have found out that despite the advances in technology, artificial intelligence and algorithm in these machines, computerized ECG reading still remains to be less accurate compared to that of reading by human experts. And the accuracy of computerized ECG interpretation is markedly lower in patients with acute ischemia or infarction, patients with pacemakers, or patients with arrhythmia. In patients with myocardial ischemia or infarction, the ECG was correctly interpreted by these algorithms in barely 60% of cases. And this is similar in patients with arrhythmia. In fact, in patients with arrhythmia or heartbeat abnormalities, the ECG was correctly read and interpreted by the computer algorithm in only 54% of cases. The remaining, they were misinterpreted as sinus rhythm. This is true in patients with pacemaker as well. In addition, these studies have shown that solely relying on the ECG interpretation by computers have led to mistakes in clinical decisions and in fact increased rate of hospitalization cost. So my take on this computerized ECG reading? Yes, they are useful. They could be adjunct on our ECG interpretation, but the results should be considered preliminary and should still be proofread and overread by experts in ECG interpretation. So now let's go back to the ECG tracing that I have showed you and examine the computer's ECG interpretation. The computer read it as sinus rhythm. We examine lead 2. It is upright in that lead. Also upright in leads 1, AVL, V4, V5, and V6, and biphasic in lead V1, all of them support that this is in fact a sinus rhythm. The second reading is possible left atrial abnormality or enlargement. So let's look at lead 2 again. You will see that the P wave is notched and wide, and the terminal portion in lead V1 is prominent and deeper than 0.03 millivolts. Those characteristics supports the left atrial abnormality. The third computer interpretation is the presence of an intraventricular conduction delay. So re-examining the QRS duration, the measurement is more than 120 milliseconds or 0.12 seconds, and that supports the presence of an IVCD. But looking closely, you can see a rabbit ear appearance or notching in lead V1. There is an R prime. And if you look at V6, the S wave is slurred and deeper. These changes support the presence of a complete right bundle branch block. The third is the possibility of a right ventricular hypertrophy. Unfortunately, in this tracing, it is more challenging to read because all the criteria made for right ventricular hypertrophy are made for QRS duration less than 120 milliseconds or in patients where there is no intraventricular conduction delay. But we can look at other supporting evidence, and one supporting evidence for the presence of possible RVH is the presence of right atrial enlargement, which is not present in this patient. Secondly, if we look at the axis, patients with RVH will have an axis which is rightward or right axis deviation more than 120 degrees. In this patient, you will see that the axis is nearly 120 degrees and it might support the presence of a possible right ventricular hypertrophy. The presence of complete right bundle branch block and right axis deviation could be seen also in patients with a concomitant RBBB plus a left posterior fascicular block producing the right axis deviation. However, this condition is not so common. So my final interpretation of this ECG, it is sinus rhythm, right axis deviation, left atrial abnormality, complete right bundle branch block, consider right ventricular hypertrophy versus a concomitant left posterior fascicular block. Thank you very much for joining me in this video. I hope you find the contents helpful in your clinical practice or even just to increase your knowledge about ECG interpretation. See you in my next video.